behalf of Center for the Study of Developing Societies and also on behalf of Institute of Chinese Studies, I take this opportunity to welcome you all for the 11th Giri Deshingkar Memorial Lecture. Giri Memorial Lectures are organized jointly by the Institute of Chinese Studies and CSDS. Professor Giri Deshingkar was closely associated with both these institutes. He was a former director of Center for the Study of Developing Societies and also the founding member of the Institute of Chinese Studies. It's my privilege to welcome today's speaker, David Shambaugh, who is a professor of political science and international affairs and the director of the China Policy Program at the Elliott School of International Affairs at George Washington University. He received numerous awards and grants, including a fellow at Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, a senior Fulbright scholar, and a distinguished research professor at Shanghai Academy of Social Sciences. Today he would be speaking on assessing China's future. The earlier speakers in the series have been Prasenjit, Duara, Hamashita, Takeshi, Ashwani, Saith, and many others. This is the 11th lecture, so there have been 10 speakers in the past. So again, I would like to welcome Professor David Shambaugh and hand it over to Professor Alkacharya.
Chinese Studies, I too take great pleasure in welcoming you all to our annual collaborative lecture in memory of Giri Dattatreya Deshingkar, who headed both our institutions in the past and whose legacy and contribution is acknowledged by both. The GDML, as they are now popularly known, were begun in 2001 as a tribute to the work and contribution of one of India's leading China experts, a philosopher of science, and an exceptional scholar on the history of India and China. As a key leader and the core founding member of the China Institute of Chinese Studies and the China Studies program at the CSDS, Giri Deshingkar's grasp spanned history, culture, literature on the one hand, and economy, politics, and foreign affairs on the other, negotiating classical and modern Chinese with equal ease. As such, he represented the quintessential area expert. The historian in him constantly challenged us, his colleagues at the ICS, to test our propositions against the history and culture of China. But he also had equal grasp over technology and philosophy, not to speak of Hindustani music and Chinese cuisine. He wore his erudition with ease, playing the part of teacher and institution builder with consummate ease. The onerous nature of his responsibilities did not allow him to complete his own project on the founding of the Qing dynasty, his first love and fascination. He later began to focus more on science and technology, enriching the discourse on arms and security with his knowledge of the technical and political aspects, adding to it the rare perspective of a historian. He played a crucial role in bringing scholars from various universities together, training younger scholars, and blending the contemporary with history, a task he was uniquely qualified to perform. Copiously published, cited, regular commentator on current developments, he contributed to the shaping of an informed Indian opinion, or at least a public opinion on China. He made critical reflections on Asian and Chinese studies, which are relevant even today. He was also a founder editor of the flagship journal of the Institute, the China Report, now in its 53rd year of continuous publication. And he had taken up the editorship for a second time at the time of his untimely demise on 2nd of November 2000. It is no less a tribute to his scholarship that leading academics have accepted our invitation to deliver this lecture most readily. So it is with Professor Shambaugh, and we are delighted to have with him on this occasion. He has already been introduced by Sanjay, should not repeat it. His topic has all the thrill of a soothsayer's prophecy, but I'm hoping that he would, by the end of his lecture, help us in raising questions. I think we are at a critical juncture in our relationship with China. Indeed, the world is in a critical juncture in its relationship with China. And I think that if we want to generate new knowledge, then we must start with a whole new set of questions. And I think Professor Shambaugh could help us in raising those new set of questions. In conclusion, I would like to acknowledge and thank our co-sponsors in this event, the India International Center, for their consistent generosity and assistance in a large number of our endeavors. Thank you very much. Over to Professor Shambaugh.
Well, good afternoon, good early evening, I guess, to everyone while we're waiting for the screen to descend from the heavens. Let me just begin by thanking you, Alka, for your most kind introduction and to the Center for Developing Societies and the Institute of China Studies for the great honor, really, and invitation to visit Delhi and give the 11th Giri Deshingkar annual lecture, which is a great tradition. I'm really, truly pleased to follow in the footsteps of 10 leading colleagues around the world, a number of whom are good personal friends, Wang, Gungwu, Elizabeth Perry, and last year's speaker, Andrew Nathan. So this is indeed a great honor and pleasure for me. It's been a number of years since I was last in Delhi, but let me begin by saying that my first professional visit to Delhi intersected with Giri Deshingkar. It's always better if someone who gives a memorial lecture actually knew the person with whom you about whom the lecture is named, and in the case of Giri, that is the case. When I was previously on the faculty at the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, and editor of the China Quarterly, one of my first missions was to try and familiarize myself with China studies all over the world. The China Quarterly claimed to be the, quote, international journal of China. I think they still have that in their masthead, but in fact, if you look at the articles published in the China Quarterly, 95% were by Americans, maybe 5% by British and Europeans, and the journal was very underrepresented in China studies and other parts of the globe. So I set off to try and meet my colleagues and learn about China studies, and that brought me here to Delhi, and I believe sometime around 1991, if memory serves, and Giri was then my counterpart, you might say, the founding editor of China Report. Glad to hear it has crossed the half century mark. That's really quite an accomplishment, 53 years. And I'm also pleased to say that I serve on the editorial board of the journal, and I read it, and it's really come a long way, and it's important reading for all of us in the field around the world. So I visited Delhi, and Giri warmly received me and helped introduce me to the China studies community here at the time. It was a very memorable visit. Seems like yesterday, but a few years have passed in between. He came to see me once at SOAS, as I recall, his own alma mater, I should note. And that too was a good, memorable interaction. And then I met him a third time, also here in Delhi, just a couple of years before his untimely passing, I think 1998 or so. So I did indeed interact and knew Giri, and through these interactions I came to know him as a very warm individual, a very serious professional, and indeed a very accomplished China scholar. His Chinese language was superb, and as Alka just mentioned, he knew not only simplified characters, but traditional characters and classical Chinese, Wen Yinwen as well. I don't know many other China scholars, certainly like not myself, who can claim that. And his understanding of the totality of China was really sweeping and really rather staggering, of his knowledge of culture, of history, which was his real love, a China historian, but also science and technology and philosophy. He was really one of these broad-gauged, today I guess we call them area studies scholars, but he was far, far more than that. Can I ask all of you to turn off your cell phones, please? This kind of intellectual depth gave him, I think, great insights into contemporary China. He also possessed he was a real role model, I would say, and certainly for the Indian China Studies community, but I think more broadly. And the likeness you have of him on the poster just now really captures his warm face. He had a great warmth to him, had a great laugh. I can still see his face in my mind, and he had great wit and sense of humor. So, you know, really a wonderful individual, and it was a pleasure for me to know him, and a great, great honor to be invited to give this lecture in his memory and honor. So, thank you all for coming. I'm going to speak on this rather small topic of China's future, which is the topic of my most recent book. And if you came this evening looking for an answer, a nice, simple takeaway answer to this very large question, I have to begin by telling you I'm going to disappoint you. There is no simple answer to such a complex topic. That's why there's a big question mark on the cover. It's an incredibly complex topic, but really one of the key ones in world affairs, the only one that may be more uncertain at this time is the future of the United States, but we can come back to that if you're interested. Trying to predict, nobody can predict the future of any country, obviously. The best, and those in the China field, you may wonder why would I even venture into this difficult territory, because the Sinological landscape, you know, is littered with Sinologists who did try one way or the other to predict China's trajectory, and many had erroneous predictions, questionable assumptions, unanswered questions, and I dare say tarnished professional reputations. So not an easy thing to do, but I think it's incumbent on specialists in any field or any country to try and do that. After all, if we in academia, specializing in this case China, cannot provide some insights into the general trajectories and trends of that country, who can? There's an awful lot of punditry out there, as we know. So I think it's incumbent that we try and peer into the future. But doing so is really difficult with a country like China, because there's so many complexities and contradictions. It reminds me of the old Indian fable of the three blind men. I don't have to tell you that felt the elephant and all three thought they were feeling a different beast, right? This is China today. For every assertion you make about China, the opposite assertion holds some validity as well. I've never in my 40 years of China watching had a greater sense of the complexities, but also the fragilities of China today. So while nobody can really predict the future, nor should they try, the best we can kind of do is as scholars, is to study the available data, use multiple sources, both Chinese sources, of course, and others inside and outside of China, and identify the principal trends and trajectories that we see at work in that country. I also think at this particular moment in China's long history that we need to, or it is very useful to view China through a comparative prism, or prisms, set of prisms. China, I think, is certainly distinct, but I don't think it is unique. It is not sui generis. Could use a little bit of light so I could see my text, but I hope you can see the screens as well. So, which is to say that China's experiencing many of the same challenges that other developing societies and economies have passed through. And I think if one looks at China through a comparative set of prisms, these are the three prisms that I think we should begin with. View China, first of all, through a comparative economic prism, as a newly industrializing economy and society, because China's beginning to face many of the same issues and challenges that many other countries that have emerged out of developing country status into this so-called middle income stage, and indeed, as economists tell us, middle income trap. China's already and has been for several years exhibiting a lot of those same similarities. So it behooves us simply to learn from others. Certainly, the challenges that China will face are similar to other newly industrializing economies. The answers may not be the same. China's size, of course, magnifies these challenges significantly, but nonetheless, they are very similar. So that's the first set of prisms I think we should draw upon. Let me give you three numbers to begin with. 101, 13, and 11. Now you might wonder what those three numbers have in common, except that they add up, I guess, to 125. So the World Bank tells us that since 1960, there have been 101 countries in the world that have emerged from developing country status into this middle income, newly industrialized status. 101 countries since 1960. Of that, only 13 have emerged through that stage to become fully mature, developed economies. They have navigated their way through the so-called middle income trap successfully, 13 out of 101. That means, first of all, that 87 did not, 87% basically, do not get out of the middle income trap. The middle income trap is the norm. It's not the exception to the rule, it is the rule. So I think that's an important takeaway when we think about China, and frankly, to anticipate what I foresee for China's economy into the future, that's exactly what I foresee. China getting bogged down and stuck in the middle income trap really indefinitely. I hope that's not true. I would like China to become a fully modern developed economy, but for reasons I'll explain in a minute, I don't see it happening absent political change. That's the key variable. So, the third number, 11. 11 of the 13 were one form or another of authoritarian political systems when they went into the trap, but all 11 emerged out of the trap as one form or another of a democratic political system. Two, Israel and Greece, were democracies to begin with going in. So there is a high correlation, if not a causal relationship, and I'm going to argue for tonight that there is a causal relationship between political liberalization and economic modernity. China faces that trap, that part of the middle income trap. Middle income trap is really a political trap that has economic consequences, I would argue. For China to innovate and move up the value-added ladder and undertake various other structural adjustments that I'll describe momentarily, really requires a significant political loosening of their political system. I didn't say democratization, but significant political loosening and liberalization. So that's the main argument of the book. That's the main argument that I'm going to put before you tonight. So China's political system has, in fact, been a major contributor to the economic success story of the last three decades, no doubt about it. Authoritarian states are very good, developmental states are very good at allocating resources towards very specified ends, and they achieve results. We've seen that. It's admirable, and no economy in the world has accomplished what China has in such a brief period of time. But going forward into the next stage, it's a different set of challenges. So that's the first comparative perspective. The second comparative perspective I think is useful to draw upon is a political one. And China is a Leninist-style political system. That's a subtype of other authoritarian political. There are a wide variety of authoritarian political systems, from sultanates, you know, single party, or single individual, I should say, dictatorships, certainly single party dictatorships, whole variety. But Leninist type authoritarian political systems have their own characteristics, which include at least the following. What I call cellular penetration of all institutions in society. That means embedding Communist Party cells inside all the institutions of the society. Hegemonic party control, and no other parties that are permitted to challenge that hegemonic rule. Core control over the personnel of the state and the party, of course, through, in the Chinese case, the so-called Central Organization Department, or Orwellian institution. Complete control over propaganda and information, the quintessential element of an Orwellian system, the Central Propaganda Department, the Zhongshanbu. The military, party control of the military. Chinese military is a party army. It's not a national army. I use that term, white scholars use that term. They certainly are prepared to defend the nation, but they are not beholden to and responsible to the state and the government. They are responsible to the Communist Party. And that gives them, amongst other things, a domestic security role. And they have rescued the Communist Party multiple times since 1949. That's different than militaries in other authoritarian style states. In fact, some authoritarian states are what we call Praetorian states, where the military actually seizes power. Leninist parties also co-opt and control social groups. This is what they call, Leninists call the United Front tactic. They have very strong internal security apparatus. They have minimal, if any, tolerance for dissent in civil society and other features. So these things distinguish Leninist party states. And I think we have, when you're looking at China today, one has to view it through that lens. Of course, there are only four Leninist party states left on the planet. North Korea, China, Vietnam, five, Laos, and Cuba. Right? All the others have gone by the way. And as I will come back to at the end of the talk, they all, every single one of them, passed through a very predictable evolution of five or six phases that scholars of Leninist systems have identified. And China is following that pattern perfectly. They are in stage five. I'll come back to that, so hold that thought. So we have to kind of view China, again, not as a kind of sui generis political system, but as a Leninist type. They call it, you know, they call it socialism with Chinese characteristics. Well, I call it Leninism with Chinese characteristics. Third comparative perspective is Chinese history. And here I wish that our historical colleagues in the China studies field would help us more. And if Yuri were here, he would be, I know. Help us understand dynastic cycles, and particularly the declining phase of dynastic cycles, which also follow rather predictable patterns and characteristics. They include popular unrest, usually peasant unrest, factional scheming within the imperial court, high levels of corruption, emperors who become isolated and tyrannical, a state ideology and doctrine that is hollow and devoid of meaning for the citizenry, economic dislocations, natural disasters, pressures on China's borders and territorial integrity from the outside, and other features. So when you look at China today, I would argue all of those, with the exception of natural disasters, are present. So I think it's the third phase. Now, dynasties take a long time to decline in Chinese history. And this dynasty, the Communist dynasty, may also take a long time. In dynastic terms, they've only been around for 67 years. That's nothing, okay? But in Leninist terms, that's pretty long. So that's the first point I want to leave you with tonight, is I think it's important to kind of step back and remind ourselves of what other countries economically and politically have passed through, and that might help us understand China. Okay, so let me briefly describe this book to you, maybe to incentivize you to order a copy. Sorry, we didn't have them available for sale tonight, but there are a couple copies outside you can examine and order on Amazon or something. It makes a great gift for your loved one if you're looking for the holidays coming. So what I'm going to do is put up a number of slides that capture what I think China's principal challenges are today. And it's no secret that China is facing a large number of very deep challenges. And they're really at a key, set of key turning points, economically, socially, politically, intellectually, technologically, in terms of their foreign policy and national security. Diminishing returns have set in with the old growth model, the very successful growth model that Deng Xiaoping began in 1978. And by the leadership's own admission, things have to change. They are quite open and transparent about that. The former premier, Wen Jiabao, just before he stepped down in 2007, he said in 2007, the year before he stepped down, rather bluntly, he described the nation's economy as characterized by what he called the four uns: unstable, unbalanced, uncoordinated, and unsustainable. That's the premier of the country, the man in charge of the Chinese economy: unstable, unbalanced, uncoordinated, and unsustainable. His successor, Li Keqiang, the current premier, also offered a fairly dire assessment last year, in 2015, and I quote, "China's economic growth model remains inefficient. Our capacity for innovation is insufficient. Overcapacity is a pronounced problem, and the foundation of agriculture is weak." That's the current premier. The current leader, paramount leader of the country, Xi Jinping, also lamented last year, and I quote, "The tasks that our party faces in reform, development, and stability are more onerous than ever. The conflicts, dangers, and challenges are more numerous than ever." So here are China's three senior leaders, all being quite open about the qualitative and very pressing set of challenges they face. So this book is really about those challenges as I see them, but I try my best to draw upon Chinese materials in researching it. So I'm going to give you a series of bullet point slides, which I'll let you sort of read and digest for yourself as they're up there. They're too long to go into in any length. I will highlight a couple of points off of each one of the most, what I see to be the most pressing of these problems. So beginning with the economy, the book has chapters on Chinese economy, society, political system, and foreign relations, and then another broader chapter on pathways to the future. So, I don't know if you can read that. Hopefully the print isn't too small, but let me highlight a couple from the second one. The need to change the macroeconomic growth model from what I call the old two, basically fixed asset investment and low wage manufacturing into low-end consumer products that are exported abroad. That's been the secret sauce of the China, plus foreign direct investment, which has come in to those joint ventures. That's been the kind of secret sauce of the last 30, 40 years. But it needs to change to the new three, an economy driven by domestic consumption, services sector, and innovation, those three. I mentioned overcapacity, and that's becoming increasingly acute. It's part of the reason for the One Belt, One Road initiative. The debt problem. Now, this is, economists tell me, perhaps the most pressing of all challenges right now. China's into very scary territory, kind of red light flashing territory. It's 282% of GDP. That is, I don't know, first, second highest in the world. The growth rate of that debt over the last 5 to 6 years is, I think, is certainly amongst the world's fastest, number two or three. And most of that is in the corporate sector, by which I mean the state-owned enterprise sector plus local government debt. Together, that accounts for almost 100%, 70% of corporate, about 25% local government. So this is a huge thundercloud hanging over the Chinese economy. Labor market, they have no real labor market as long as they have a hukou system, which is violated, but the market for labor doesn't respond really to supply and demand. in localities. People cannot move around the country, at least legally, to meet needs. Currency, weak. They've had to prop it up. So somebody should tell that to President Trump. He seems to think the Chinese currency, he's about 10 years out of date on the Chinese currency. Not 10, but he's 5 years out of date on the Chinese currency. Let's see, financial sector restructuring from top to bottom. China doesn't have banks. China has pass-through conduits for central subsidies to flow to targeted institutions and local governments. So they need to, first of all, create a real banking system that operates on the basis of collateral. That's why they have this debt problem, right? $28 billion, I think, is the figure in outstanding debt. They're not going to get that money back. There's no collateral on it. Housing bubbles, we now are in the middle of the third large housing bubble in the last 4 or 5 years, not just in so-called tier one eastern cities, but increasingly in the interior of the country. Capital outflight, challenges to innovation, which I'll come back to. So I don't know if you can read these, but those are amongst the most significant economic challenges. Now, you might say, what about the third plenum reform package? And the answer is the third plenum reform package, which was announced in 2013, addresses almost all of these problems, save really the debt issue. But here we are, 2017, and by most economists and analysts' assessments, only about 15% of that third plenum reform package, which included 64 categories and 340 some odd individual initiatives, only about 20% at best of those initiatives have been implemented in the last 4 years. In other words, it never took off. It's dead in the water. And there, why is it dead in the water? Well, there's been very stiff resistance from vested interest groups, as you might anticipate. There's been the collateral side effect of the anti-corruption campaign, which is very necessary for its own reasons, but has hit the cadre core extremely hard. And cadres are very risk-averse under that environment. They don't even go to the office and do their day jobs. And that has contributed to the non-implementation of the package, too. There's a great deal of uncertainty in high-level economic policymaking. Who makes it? You know, we really don't know. There's this man, Liu He, who is Xi Jinping's number one advisor. But beyond Liu He and the head of the central bank, Dai Shangmeng, is that his name? One really cannot identify 5 or 10 key people who are making China's economic policies today for the first time in 30 years. We've always been able to do that. So there's a kind of opacity to the policymaking process. There's also been an over-reliance on fiscal stimulus to pump up the economy. That's their default mechanism. Times get tough, pump money into the system. Saw it again last week on the verge of Chinese New Year's. So as long as they're pumping money into the system, they're fueling the debt problem, they're postponing the hard work of implementing the reforms that they outlined. And the reforms they outlined, I would note, came without any sense of prioritization or sequencing. They just sort of threw them all out there, 364 of them. So, but if you're a cadre and you want to be told, what do I do first, what do I do second, what do I do third? There was no sense of that, no sense of sequencing. So for all those reasons, however well written and well informed and intended the third plenum package was, it hasn't gone anywhere to date. What about society? This is a little easier to read. Oh, sorry. There is some good economic news. I don't want to leave you thinking that the Chinese economy is a complete mess. It's not. One bullet point I should have up here is that the private sector is now really driving the economy. 70% of GDP growth comes from the private sector. GDP growth still up in the 6 to 7% range. They have undertaken to eliminate a lot of red tape by the state council and at provincial and sub-provincial levels. They are, you know, they're very aware of the role that innovation plays reason getting through the middle income trap. They're keenly aware of it. And they're creating innovation hubs in Shenzhen in particular, but also Chongqing and Beijing. And they are investing increased amounts in R&D, which is important for any state. China's investment, central level investment into R&D is now 2.3%, which is low relative to OECD level countries, right? Highest in the world, South Korea, 3.6%, followed by Japan at 3.5%, Taiwan at 3.3%, United States is around 3%, Germany, or maybe it's Germany that's 3%, United States 2.9%, and so on. All, you know, developed, Canada also up there. China's at 2.3%, and that's up from 1.8% just last year. So there's been a spike in R&D funding. And they are going to get results from that investment. You know, if you water a plant, the plant will grow. And the Chinese government is investing significant resources now into that. You know, 2.3% of a $10 trillion economy, you can do the math on it. And they are investing it in priority sectors. They've identified, I think, 11 priority sectors they want to be world leaders in. Biotech, nanotech, green energy in particular, including electric cars. Actually, I was in Beijing just before Christmas and saw several electric cars on the street, which I'd never seen before. Nuclear medicine, aerospace, and several others that don't come to mind. So they are aware, and several in the electronics domain, they're very aware of where their comparative advantages lie, and if they want to water the plant, they're going to get growth in those areas. But innovation is a more complicated subject. It comes from several dimensions. It comes top down, as I just described. All states invest in that. But it comes bottom up in what I call outside in. It comes from society. It comes from an educational system in particular. It comes from individuals, people who are willing to tinker and take risks and not get penalized for failing. Chinese culture, I think Gary, I would be interested in what Gary would think about this proposition. It's a very risk-averse culture, traditionally. It's entrepreneurial. You might think, oh, Professor Shambaugh, what are you talking about? Of course it's an entrepreneurial place. Entrepreneurship is a kind of risk. But invention is a different proposition than entrepreneurship, I would argue. And it takes a much more free society and small business loans, other facilitating features to get people to take those risks. You need an open media, you need civil society, you need an intellectual class. And then you need what I call the outside in. You've got to be connected to the world 24/7, you know, 365 days a year to interact with colleagues in whatever field you're in around the world. Well, obviously given China's extreme internet control, top three in the world, not to mention other social media controls. It's difficult for Chinese to interact with their colleagues in Bangalore or Silicon Valley. So I think innovation is the key to China's future. They're going to get some growth in the plant, but the plant's not going to grow as broadly without absent political reform, in my view. Okay. So society. Another long list that you probably can't see. Let me just note a couple of these. The second bullet says middle upper classes moving assets abroad. This has been going on now for some time, but has accelerated in the last 2 to 3 years. China's middle and wealthy classes, many of whom are party members, I would note, are parking their personal assets in foreign property, foreign bank accounts, moving their kids abroad, their relatives abroad. They've got 1 foot out the door. This is hedging behavior, to be sure, but they're ready to move the second foot out the door as soon as the place begins to crumble. They evince a great deal of uncertainty at best, if not outright skepticism about their own country's future. That's a very telling fact to me. Anytime a country's elite and 1 foot out the door, that doesn't speak well of their own confidence in their country's future. volatile periphery, Xinjiang, Tibet, Hong Kong, Taiwan, all the way around their western and southern periphery. Each of those four places have different sources of unrest, but they're all very restive and difficult for the central government to manage. And then I have a series of bullet points that basically boil down to one word that starts with R, repression. China, in the last 8 years, it began before Xi Jinping came to power. It started in 2009. I happened to be living there that year, but China began to crack down on civil society, on media, on dissent, on lawyers, on intellectuals. Of course, intellectuals have never had a very good time in communist China. And then it has intensified under Xi Jinping. It's, I think, fair to say the most repressive China has been since the aftermath of the Tiananmen events of 1989 in the early 90s. I lived there then too. It's not as bad now as it was then. That was martial law, I can tell you. It was very draconian. But it's very serious today. And so that's breeding all kinds of frustrations in those classes, from journalists to intellectuals to students. You can't use foreign textbooks in Chinese universities now, according to the Ministry of Education, and so on. So I'll come back to the significance of that in a moment. But repression, demographic transition is a huge variable here. China's baby boom generation has, as of 2015, crossed the threshold into retirement. We're going to see another 100 million people go into retirement by the year 2025. These are people that are going to have to be supported in retirement. Supported how? First of all, supported by their only child. And second of all, supported by the only child because the pension system is so inadequate. They do have pensions, and the government has seen this coming on the horizon. And so they've been investing or subsidizing pension system and the healthcare system. These are two good things the Chinese have been doing in the last few years, healthcare, pension investment, because they can see the trends coming. That's different than India, for example, the demographic profile of other developing countries. So this is an aging society, and that's going to become an increasingly difficult issue. So those are amongst the most significant social issues. They cross over many of those into the political domain. Again, I'm sorry, you probably can't read these where you're sitting, but I've already mentioned a number of them. The culture of fear amongst the cadre corps today, which has resulted in a frozen policy apparatus, all of which has come out of the anti-corruption campaign. Again, a very necessary, successful campaign in which just shy of 200,000 party members have been disciplined. But in a party of 88 million, 200,000 is a drop in the bucket. Okay, but it's had a real stultifying effect on what they call dangdashenghuo, party life. Repression I just spoke of, media control I just spoke of, stifled educational system I just spoke of, local government legitimacy deficit. So if you read surveys of Chinese citizens, which occasionally can do. My colleague at George Washington, Bruce Dixon, has a brand new and very good book out called The Dictator's Dilemma that I would recommend to you, drawn entirely on surveys. There's a number of interesting findings, but one finding in all these surveys note is the almost complete lack of confidence in local governments by local citizens. Chinese have very high confidence in their central government, but minimal confidence in their local government, just a flip of the American system, interestingly enough. So the party, in other words, and the state bureaucracy at the local level, really not respected. That's a key legitimacy factor. And as I mentioned, alienated middle and upper classes who are moving abroad. So society, I see Chinese society is actually very volatile. There's a kind of veneer of stability there. There are frustrations across many classes of society, just waiting really to burst, in my view. And then finally, there's a chapter on Chinese foreign affairs and China in the world. So as this slide indicates, if you look across the world map, I at least find China's foreign relations to be mixed. They're not particularly good, and they're not really terrible. But in virtually every region, it varies by region. It's worse in some regions than others. It's worse with some countries than others. And it fluctuates. I mean, right now, I would say that China's image and relationships abroad are probably better than they were 18 months to 2 years ago. We just saw Xi Jinping give the speech in Davos at the World Economic Forum when she becomes the defender, claims that China is now going to be the guarantor of globalization and the open trading system. Very reassuring speech, to be sure, especially with everybody so nervous about President Trump in the United States, but it's a little disingenuous. China certainly has been a major beneficiary, perhaps the major beneficiary of globalization in the world. It's not the upholder of globalization within their own borders, right? This is still a highly mercantilist, protectionist economy. Foreign companies have been struggling increasingly in recent years. Just read the reports of the American Chambers of Commerce in Beijing, if you don't believe me. They're having a real tough time since around 2010 or so. A lot of them most of them have all lowered their footprints in China. Their profit margins are shrinking. They've got one foot out the door, and that they're putting it somewhere else, India, Indonesia, Mexico, other places. So you're the beneficiary of this increasing pressurized commercial environment inside of China. And it's very difficult to get expats to move to China now because of the pollution. High cost of operation in China cuts into your profit margin. So foreign multinationals having difficulty there. But looking more broadly at China's foreign relations, we do see strain, I would argue. We see strain around China's periphery in Asia over the last several years. It comes from different sources, South China Sea most recently. There is an opportunity potentially for China now if Trump and the Americans relatively pull back from the region. I actually don't think that's going to happen. I certainly hope it doesn't happen. But that's going to leave an opportunity for China to walk into a vacuum, so to speak. We can talk about that if you're interested. That is already apparent in Southeast Asia. I'm actually now living in Singapore for 6 months, and I've been traveling around Southeast Asia, and it's already, the nervousness about the United States is very apparent, but the gravitational pull, you might say, of China, equally apparent in conversations. Relations, China's footprint in the Middle East, never been very deep or broad. It's going up a little bit now. Africa has been very deep for a very long time, but that's turning. It's not so positive. If you look at public opinion polls and read the African media about China, it's not nearly as positive as it was a few years ago. Similarly, in Europe, public perception. Europe is, if you look at, again, public surveys, the highest in the world. Negative ratings, negative views about China are in Europe. North America, you have to disaggregate Canada from the US, of course. Canadians have more positive views of China and the U.S., but American views, be they public or elites, have been trending increasingly negative as well. So in Latin America, China's relations are generally positive there. So if you look across the planet, they get a B plus, I think, on their foreign policy, which is not bad. Their hard power, B plus. Mixed, that's to be predicted for a rising power. Not everybody is going to love you. You have to anticipate criticism. You have to anticipate difficulties. People who don't want to play your game and do things the way you want them to do. China's beginning to encounter pushback, I sense, in a variety of parts of the world. Hard power, certainly increasing. Military power, that's what I mean by that. Soft power, broadly speaking, I would still say is lacking. One area where I'd give China serious credit, though, is in the global governance arena. Here we see in the last, really 4 years since Xi Jinping came to power, China really upping its game. They were criticized, rightfully so, I think, by Westerners for being free riders in the international system. You'll recall the famous speech by Robert Zoellick to become a so-called responsible international stakeholder. China was free riding up until about 4 years ago. We have really seen increased activity and allocation of resources and investments in a whole variety of things, beginning with climate change. That's all good news. And I would argue it have now met, largely speaking, Zoellick's call for being a responsible international stakeholder. So that's one piece of good news. Trump is a huge uncertainty, and he could potentially give China a golden opportunity to expand its own influence, certainly in Asia. Okay, so that's essentially what the book is about. Let me now turn to the sort of argument and the predictions, if you will. So this slide, obviously, is a graphic of four alternative futures. And I decided to use the metaphor of a roundabout. And it's not really a crossroads. That's kind of a false choice for China. Any country has alternatives, right? Not just left or right. So China is, it's very important to know when you're a car or a nation what route you are on coming into the roundabout, because political scientists will tell us that there's a high propensity for what's known as path dependency. It's a silly term for a very commonsensical phenomenon. People keep doing what's comfortable and what has worked. So since 2009, China has been on this hard authoritarian path that I mentioned, predated Xi Jinping, is intensified under him. So that's the route that they come in on. So they have four alternatives. The first is simply to stay on that second left-hand turning, the hard authoritarian path. But the consequences, I'll show you in a second, the consequences of each of these four. Or it could become even harder, and they could go back or lurch leftward, you might say, into a neo-totalitarian system, such as it was in the early 1990s after Tiananmen. So it's not as bad now as it was then, but it's trending in that direction. And I could envision, conceptually at least, certain circumstances and certain leaders, certain hardline conservative leaders, and China has no shortage of hardline conservative leaders, who could come to power and say, we've got to tighten down even more. So it could get the repression could get worse. Or on the other side of the screen, they could move back to the soft authoritarian path that they were on from 1998 to 2008. Under Jiang Zemin, last part of Jiang Zemin's tenure and the first part of Hu Jintao's tenure. The one commonality to those two leaders is a man named Zeng Qinhong. Zeng Qinhong, now retired, was Jiang Zemin's right-hand man. He finished his career as the number two leading person in the party. And he's a complicated figure, but amongst other things, he's a serious political reformer. And he studied intensively the causes of collapse of the Soviet Union and the East European parties, and he drew a number of lessons from them that were codified in the fourth plenary session of the 16th Central Committee communique. So if you're interested in this stuff, you should go back and read that communique, and then read the speech he gave the next day, interpreting the communique. So if you know how the Chinese operate, the speech of the leader who interprets the document is more important, actually, than the document. But you should read them in tandem. And if you do, the basic conclusion was that, you'll be surprised by this, that Gorbachev's reforms were, in fact, well-intended, but they were too late. The system was too brittle, could not take the shock therapy, and crashed. He said, therefore, what you need to do is manage progressive, incremental political opening over time. And you work together with economic reforms and other social reforms, and you move to a more open position for the party that will extend its longevity. In other words, he was very scathing in this speech about sclerotic, he called it, sclerosis, parties that just hunker down and close rather than open. So that was Zheng Qinhuang. That's what they were doing for 10 years. That's what they could go back to doing. So this isn't a new departure, I'm arguing, they need to do. It's actually a return. And Alka and I were talking at lunch today about how since 1978, China has gone through a series of what China specialists call the Fang Shou cycle. Fang for opening, Shou for closing. There have been six Fang Shou cycles since 1978. The Fang periods, the opening periods, last about 6 to 7 years. The closing periods about 2 to 3 years. And then they get back to 6 or 7 more years of opening. So that's been the repetitive pattern up until 2009. We are now, ladies and gentlemen, in year 8 of Shou. They are long overdue for opening. But from what I can see, there's no inclination to go in that direction. This hard authoritarian leadership doesn't want to go there. They think that is a recipe for collapse. And there was a big struggle in the party against Zheng Qinhuang. He said, no, you cannot manage control. You cannot manage opening because you will lose control. So we don't want to go there in the first place. And they, series of events transpired in 2009, I can tell you about, including Zheng Qinhuang's retirement, but a number of other events that made them pivot to a hard authoritarian path. And then finally, they could go into a more semi-democratic route. If I had to do this slide over, though, I would have that growing, evolving out of soft authoritarianism, because no democracy of these 11 newly industrialized economies I mentioned, every one of them passed through a soft authoritarian political phase before they evolved into a semi-democratic or fully democratic phase. So it's not really like going into a restaurant and ordering semi-democracy off a la carte off of the menu. So those are the four paths to the future that I envision. What happens if they take each of those four pathways? This slide, if you can read it, are, I think, the consequences and the argument of the book. So if they stay where they are now, hard authoritarianism, they're going to get a limited economic reform. They're not going to be absent economic reform, but they're not going to achieve the third plenum package. They're going to be basically where they are now, 15% implementation. They're going to get relative economic stagnation, by which I mean growth rates still in the 3 to 6% range, more in the 5 to 6% range. In a $10 trillion economy, it's hard to call that stagnation. But it does mean that they're not biting the bullet and making those tough structural choices in the economy. So if you see a lower growth rate, a 2 to 3% growth rate, it would be commensurate with the countries that successfully navigated the middle income trap and would indicate, in fact, that they are making some of those tough choices. So high growth rates, don't be deceived. That shows that they're not addressing the problems. Lower growth rates, perhaps better chances. And then protracted political decline. Let me be absolutely clear here. I am not predicting the collapse of China or even the Chinese Communist Party. I don't want the collapse of China. It's not my analytical judgment either, despite the Wall Street Journal title of an article I published a couple of years ago. But I do see the party and political system in protracted decline. It could lead over time to collapse. Soviet Union, one can argue, began to decline when Brezhnev overthrew Khrushchev in 1964. It didn't collapse until 1991. That's 27 years of decline. So we don't, and one never knows when these systems crack. All you can do is look for the cracks and see where they may be. I would note you should look at the internal security services, when they stop being as rigorous in the enforcement of their jobs. I would look at the propaganda system and the control apparatus. When the control apparatus of Lenin's party state begins to wither, then you know the whole edifice is shaking and could come down. No, that is not happening. I want to be very clear. That's not happening in China. The control apparatus, it looks to be as strong as ever. But I know a lot of party members who are not at all content with the direction that Xi Jinping has taken the party and the country in recent years. So if that's any indication, you can assume there are people in the, you know, in the propaganda system who are having to institute the censorship. There are even people in the security services that may not be on board with that either. Okay, so that's what happens if they stay on this path. As I say, if they go back to the neo-totalitarian path, that's only going to accelerate those trends. Similarly, they move to soft authoritarianism, they'll have better chances of economic reform, but not total success, and partial economic transition through the middle-income trap. Semi-democracy, a la Singapore. If you wonder, Professor Shambaugh, what do you have in mind? Singapore, which has a number of attributes of a democratic system. We all know it's not a full, perfect democratic system, but it's got a robust civil society, has a relatively open media, has competitive parties that do compete, they just never win. You know, so think about it, the Chinese Communist Party. They could empower the other eight. There are eight other political parties in China, but they're all united front instruments of the Communist Party. So a number of aspects, and they have no corruption in Singapore, they've got a first-class civil service, and so on. Of course, Singapore, where I'm living now, is a small island city-state. It's not 1.4 billion people, but I think that's... So those are the possibilities. Now, let me try and bring this to conclusion with a couple of other thoughts for you to digest. Coming back to this issue of the need for political opening to facilitate economic, continued qualitative economic transition. That's the issue. It's not economic growth, it's economic transition up the value-added chain. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Ian Bremner and his book, The J Curve. Well, this is Bremner's concept, and he argues that there is a direct correlation between openness of the political system and the stability, in fact, of the political system. So he's not really looking at this from an economist's standpoint, but he sees China up here on the left-hand end of the curve. It's going to have to go through some instability before it could make those changes that he thinks are necessary also. Then one other book I would mention that I'm quite impressed with, it's by two American scholars at MIT called James Robinson and Darren Acemoglu, who published a book called Why Nations Fail. And they too, they argue that for countries or newly industrializing economies to move up that ladder, political institutions have to become facilitative and stop becoming what they describe as extractive. So the Chinese party state is a classic extractive state. It's got to empower, it's got to change that, empower lower level elements of civil society and institutions, deregulate to facilitate more autonomy in the society, to create the market forces necessary. So Bremner and these two MIT scholars, I think, have something to offer us. But those of you, and Gary would certainly agree with this if he was here in this Center for Developing Societies. This is not new news to social scientists or modernization theorists. This is classic sort of 1960s modernization theory, a la Lipset, Huntington, Rostow, Morganski, Inkeles, Apter, and others. If you've read that literature, those of my generation were reared on that literature in graduate school. So I think we need to go back and refresh ourselves on that literature. I think it's still quite relevant to our understanding of authoritarian regimes. They all argue that authoritarian regimes are very ill-equipped to navigate through that trap. And indeed, the 13 countries I mentioned have proven them basically right, or the 87 as well. In other words, these political systems fail to what Huntington called adapt. The term adaptation is crucial here. I published a previous book called China's Communist Party, Atrophy and Adaptation. Some of you who read that might think, oh boy, he's really changed his tune. No, I don't think so. The subtitle of that book was Atrophy and Adaptation. Atrophy is the common malady of all Leninist regimes. They all atrophy. The question is, do they adapt to try and rectify the atrophy? I would argue then, this book came out in 2008, at the end of that 10-year period I described, that they were adapting under Zheng Qinhong. But then, boom, they stopped in 2009. So modernization theorists, I think, have a lot to teach us. And then, lastly, scholars of Leninist systems. So I promised you the what I call the Leninist life cycle. These are 6 phases that all the extant Leninist political systems have passed through in the last 100 years. Revolution, seizure of power, consolidation of state power, and extension of it over all aspects of society, that's called totalitarianism. Transformation and mobilization of society, that's what we saw in China beginning with the Great Leap, even before the Great Leap, all the way through the Cultural Revolution into the 1970s. Extraction of resources and capital from society for state purposes, in essence, that's what we've seen in the 80s and the 90s. Then, what scholars call the Brezhnevization, and which is bureaucratization of state power. We saw that in the 90s, and it's grown since then. The state sector of the economy today is 40% of GDP. And then in the last phase, adaptation and limited pluralism to cope with the stagnation and ossification of stage 5, ending with a question mark. Why? Because not a single Leninist state has been successful in adapting and creating limited pluralism and the institutions thereof on any kind of permanent basis. China was trying to do that in the 1980s. That's what Zhao Ziyang understood very well. That's what Zheng Qinhong understood very well. There are still people in the party in China who understand that very well. But if they don't answer that question with adaptation, then they are on, in my view, a protracted decline. Let me just close by quoting one of my intellectual heroes, Zbigniew Brzezinski, who, of course, is, amongst other things, a leading scholar of Leninist political systems. And in 2 years before the Soviet Union collapsed in 1989, it collapsed in 91, 2 years before, he published his book called The Grand Failure. I recommend you go back and read that. And he described in it Communist Party states in this penultimate, next and more abundant phase. He said, in this phase, and I quote, the communist leadership loses confidence, evinces a deep insecurity, and tries to reassert control. Rule becomes rule for rule's sake. The governing rationale is stripped bare to its core, maintaining power, unquote. Well, when I think of the Xi Jinping regime today, Brzezinski's words resonate with me. That's exactly what we're seeing today. This regime is highly insecure. It's not confident. If they were confident, they'd be opening up. They're not. They're cracking down. And as I said, the elite are leaving the country in ever-increasing numbers. $982 billion in 2015, according to Standard Chartered Bank, left the country. That's not outbound investment. That's personal asset and wealth being moved abroad. So we've got an increasingly insecure party at home and the elite leaving. Where does this leave us? Is the place going to collapse? No, not going to collapse, but we'll have relative economic stagnation, more acute social instability, and more protracted, in my view, political decline. It's a very profound dilemma for China. And really, the question at the end of the day, they can stay on course number 2, that's what they're going to get. They can go back to soft authoritarianism and have better chances. The ultimate question is, does the regime have the confidence to open up politically in order to succeed economically and socially? So the relationship is now flipped. Politics is the independent variable. Economics is now the dependent variable, which for the last 30 years, it's really been the other way around. So with that, I will stop, and I'd be happy to take any of your comments and questions, and thank you for your attention.